yesterday morning, they let me know you were gone. Suzanne the plantain may put an end to you. I walked out this morning and I wrote down this song. I just can't remember who to send it to. I've seen fire and I've seen rain. I've seen sunny days that I thought would never end. I've seen lonely times when I could not find a friend. But I always thought that I'd see you again. Won't you look down upon me, Jesus? You gotta help me make a stand. You just got to see me through another day. My body's aching and my time.
Well, good morning, everyone.
Morning.
We're happy all of you have joined us today for the celebration of life for Jim Bob. Today's a difficult day for everybody that knew Jim. And I'm sure he would have been touched by all of you who have come to pay your respects and to celebrate his life. From what I've been told, Jim was always up for a party regardless of the reason. James Frederick Bob was born on August 15th, 1950. He was born in Detroit, Michigan. Jim grew up in the tough part of town, the kind of neighborhood where you wouldn't walk around alone at night. being from Detroit, gotta make sure I pronounce that correctly. Jim, of course, was a faithful Pistons, Lions, and especially the Red Wings fan all of his life. He was also a NASCAR fan during the Dale Earnhardt era. A man for all seasons, as the saying goes. Jim has survived his sister Martha, his nephews Michael and Brian, and his niece Renee. And of course, we can't forget about his best friend Ted, aka Teddy Two Shoes, Moore. After high school, like many young men of that time, Jim went into the military. But you gotta understand, he didn't just go into the military. Jim enlisted into the United States Marine Corps. It was the end of the 60s. So after basic training, Jim went straight to Vietnam, where he spent 4 years on the front lines. Things didn't get any easier for Jim when he returned from the war. His mom died in 1976, and his brother Bob, aka Bebop, was still young and living at home at the time. So after their mother passed, Bebop went to live with Martha. If losing their mom wasn't enough, they lost their father soon after, in 1985. But by then, Bebop was living with Jim, and they were pretty much inseparable. To say they lived like simple bachelors would be a tremendous understatement. They weren't into anything excess, unless it involved the party. From what I've been told, if you were to go to their house, you'd find four plates, four forks, four spoons, and four knives to eat with, because that's all they needed. They lived within their means, and they had what they needed, but they didn't really need much else. Another very special friend in Jim's life was Snooky the dog. Now, from what I can tell, nobody seems to know what breed or gender Snooky was. But, or honestly, how long the dog lived. But after a few drinks, Jim loved to tell stories about Snooky. After his time in the Marine Corps, Jim became an automotive exhaust mechanic. There's a clipping up there from where he worked. He spent some time as a chef at Disney World. Kind of a unique career choice for a prior mechanic and soldier. But that was Jim. He was unique. From what I've been told, Jim traveled the road less traveled by, which was mostly down the back roads of Daytona Beach at night after a night on the town. He was quiet before you got to know him. But once you were in the circle of trust, he'd give you the shirt off his back. From what Debbie's told me, once you got past his quiet exterior, Jim was one of the most loyal friends you could ever have. That's how she described him, loyal. Now, the only time you'd ever see Jim in a pair of pants was when he was working. Most other times you'd see him in a pair of shorts, some flip-flops, and a free t-shirt he got from a bar or at a casino somewhere. He loved to sit at the bar with his drink and his Tic Tacs and tell stories about his humble beginnings in Detroit and how he overcame adversity that he experienced in his life. And listen, I'm not going to sugarcoat things. Jim was passionate about gambling, rock and roll, cigarettes, and alcohol. Don't usually hear that in church. So he spent a lot of time in Costa Rica, Las Vegas, and Key West enjoying those very things. But listen, there was one thing that Jim loved even more, one thing that he was more passionate about than any of that stuff, and that was his brother, Bebop. Jim loved Bebop with all his heart, was sold. And when he passed, Jim was never the same. When Bebop died, Jim didn't just lose his brother. He also lost his son, his best friend, his partner in crime, and truthfully, his reason for living. Jim suffered from heart disease for a large part of his life, but it got much worse after Bebop passed. Sometimes when we lose those that we love, when they're gone, many of us lose our desire to live. Jim passed from this world into the next on January 28th of this year. And look, I know all of us like to think we're going to live forever. But the truth is, every person here will one day stop breathing. I know we don't like to think about it, but it's true. Our lives, like Jim's and Bebop's, will one day come to an end. We make plans, we save our money, we put that inevitable ending out of our minds so we don't have to think about it. But one day, just like Jim, we will pass from this life. James 4, 13 through 14 says, look here, you say, today or tomorrow we're going to a certain town and we'll stay there a year. We will do business and make a profit. How will you know what your life will be like tomorrow? Your life is like a morning fog. It's here for a little while and then it's gone. One thing we should always do at a memorial service for someone we care about is take stock of our own lives. Ask ourselves this question: are we the people that we want to be? Are we living the lives that we want to live? Are we leaving a legacy that we want to leave? And most importantly, where are we with our Creator? Folks, I'm not trying to bring you down this morning. I'm not trying to even make you think about your death. I certainly don't want anything from you. I want something for you. I'm not going to punches. I want you to be a follower of Jesus Christ. Not because I want you to be members of our church, and not because I want you to give us anything, but because by confessing Christ, you secure a place in heaven. You know, heaven isn't what people think it is. From what I read in the Bible, it's not a bunch of people sitting on clouds, playing harps, and wearing togas. It's not what I read. In Revelation 21, verses 3 and 4, it says, I heard a loud shout from the throne saying, look, God, his home is now among his people. He will live with them, and they will be his people. God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes, and there will be no more death, or sorrow, or crying, or pain. All these things are gone forever. And then in verses 21 through 27, it says, the 12 gates were made of pearls, each gate from a single pearl. And the main street was pure gold, as clear as glass. I saw no temple in the city, for the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are its temple. And the city has no need for sun or the moon, for the glory of God illuminates the city, and the Lamb is its light. The nations will walk in its light, and the kings of the world will enter the city in all their glory. Its gate will never be closed at the end of the day, because there is no night there. And all the nations will bring their glory and honor into the city. Nothing evil will ever be allowed to enter, nor anyone who practices idolatry and dishonesty, but only those whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. I don't know about you, but when I think of that and I read that, it sounds like a pretty cool place. Based on what I've been told about Jim, I believe that's where he is today. Let me tell you why. Debbie told me that Jim believed in God and prayed regularly. He was raised in the Catholic Church, and he went through his confirmation. Now, for those of you not familiar with the Catholic Church, which I am, confirmation is a ceremony where Catholics confess their belief in Jesus Christ and they reject Satan. We choose who we're going to follow. Contrary to popular belief, when we pass, St. Peter isn't going to be at the front gate. He's not going to be there negotiating with people whether they can come in. Peter's not a bouncer at a bar or a nightclub. And truthfully, it's not going to matter who you know or what you did while you were here on earth. It's simply going to come down to whether or not you have confessed Christ as Lord and Savior. Because those who have, their names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. There are only two types of people, those who are believers and those who are not. If you've never confessed Christ in your life, I'm going to show you how. I wouldn't be doing my job as a minister of the gospel if I didn't. Romans 3:23 tells us, for everyone has sinned and falls short of God's glorious standard. I don't think that's a surprise to anybody. Romans 6:23 tells us that there's a payment that has to be made for our sin. For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Now, contrary to popular belief, you don't have to join a church. You don't have to give money. You don't have to stand up and tell your life story. It's not the way it works. Romans 10:9-10. If you openly declare that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Mm-hmm. For it's by believing in your heart that you're made right with God, and by openly declaring your faith that you're saved. Romans 10:13. This is how I know that Jim is in heaven. For everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. Calling on the Lord Jesus and asking him to come into your life is the sacrifice for your sin. And it's the only way that your name gets written in the book of life. And look, those aren't my rules. There's no use arguing with me. It's what the Bible says. But I'd like to end this afternoon, or actually this morning, with one final thought. As you guys gather as family and friends this afternoon, listening to music or having a drink with friends, you should take time to honor the life of Jim Bob. Tell stories, laugh, cry, but above all, celebrate his life and what he stood for. In church, let's remember his close friends and family. Let's gather around them, love on them, and pray for them. That's what we're called to do. Because the truth is, after we leave here today and we get back to our daily lives, the loss of Jim is something that his family and friends will continue to deal with every single day. Thank you all for coming today. I pray that God blesses each one of you. Michael, he's going to read a eulogy he's prepared for Jim. Close our eyes, lost in love.
right, so I'm not going to read anything. I'm going to speak from my heart. And my Uncle Jim, and thank you all for being here. And I'm taking this from the way my Uncle Jim would want it to be. He said I was his upper, and Uncle Jim, as Pastor Frankie, fantastic. Your words were fantastic. He was always there for a good time. So I know it's cliche to say that we're going to celebrate life, but that's the way my Uncle Jim would want it. And I want today to be a celebration, and he'd want more laughter than he'd want tears. And that's the way. So I love the way you put to honor his life, and I think that's why my uncle, his legacy will continue to live on. If we think about, again, asking us to do better for ourselves, how we can take what was great about Uncle Jim. He wasn't perfect, but what he had is he cared about other people. He had a great heart, he was genuine, he wanted others to have a good time. And if we could just be a little kinder as a community, as a nation, and we keep that, maybe say thank you, those little things, that extra smile. I love Jim's laugh. I mean, I can't duplicate it, but it was kind of like that. Or, or his expressions. Come on, tough guy. Or what are you talking about, Willis? He wanted to lighten the mood. And that's what I remember of my uncle. And I had the benefit of when we were together over, and I figured this out on the plane as I was flying here, and I actually wrote some notes, and I don't know what you're like, on a cocktail napkin. Because I know that's what you were like. But we were on vacation most of the time, and Jim chose wisely, came out to Florida. I chose wisely. I moved out of Detroit, which we both are very proud of, and went to Arizona. So we had a lot of great times. But that's my memories, and it's weird because I'm getting a Pistons jersey because that's what, and I'm putting Bob on the back because that was my connection with my Uncle Jim. But it's weird, I didn't know what number I was going to put on it. And when I'm on the plane, the number 4 kept coming up. Because from the time I was 4, I realized to the last time that I saw him, we're going to the pint-sized pub, and I surprised him and scared the heck out of him when I walked in there 44 years later. And Ted, thank you and Deb for making that happen. For 44 years, I got to see the best of my Uncle Jim. And that's what I want to celebrate today. And I can talk and talk and talk, and I'm going to go in a lot of different ways, and I'm not going to talk for too long, Uncle Jim, but I'm going to and want you to know the kind person he is and how he can continue to live. So the Pistons thing with the 4, from the time I was 4, my first memory of my uncle. Okay, here we are. I'm sure my parents just wanted like a night for themselves, but they took me and my sister over to my Uncle Jim's, and Snooky, he was a terror. He tore up couches. We were scared of him. I think they put him in a pin. But we were 4 years old, and what I remember is jumping on a waterbed and my Uncle Jim making us French waffles because he didn't have toast the morning after. And that's the person he was. And from then on, I remember telling my mom that I wanted a waterbed because Uncle Jim has a waterbed. And she's like, well, you can't have one until you're 13 years old. That's a different story. But anyway, it was the influence of my uncle. And throughout time, as I grew up, as a young adult, the thing about Uncle Jim, he wasn't always like there because we were different places, but every memory is fantastic. And he was there when you needed him. And I'm not sure why Michigan is surrounding him right now.
I'm not either.
Because one of the things that my uncle, because, he was up for the party, but he showed up at my graduation. I graduated from Notre Dame, so I'm still confused about the Michigan thing that's going on right now, and I'm having a hard time. But
it was the DJ.
Okay. There you go, Tracy. And thank you. But he was always good. You have certain memories, and that's where I think I'm going to come conclude. Thoughts, when I see my uncle, I see him at coaches where he was hanging with me and all of my friends, and I was and staying out till 1 o'clock in the morning. I know he's gotten to a routine, but I was always able to get Jim a little bit out of his routine, and he was able to experiment, and he finally figured out that there is Mexican food in other states as well, not just here in Florida. But I still see his face as I look at all of you right now when we're there that night, and he cared. I see him. I will share a funny story. Uncle Jim getting up in the morning, he was out in Arizona, goes in the refrigerator, he takes out an olive, and Uncle Jim, his facial expression, he was very animated. At least that's what I knew. I didn't know Uncle Jim is a quiet person. He was animated. He's like, "What do you have in these olives?" Well, they were being soaked in vermouth, but that's a different thing. He's like, and at 9 o'clock in the morning, that really hit him. But so as we go on, and again, I think about the things that you said and that go out to me. You know, when he was a very generous person. He cared, and he wanted to always give his best. And he didn't always have the means because he only had four of each of those. That's interesting, though, that before that didn't even hit me until now, the four forks. But he would find a way to do something. So the last time I was actually in Orlando, I came out for a Notre Dame game, not against Michigan, and we went to see him play Florida State. And he found a way to get a park hopper pass because, as some of you know, Jim always seemed to know someone who knows someone who knows someone who knows someone. And he got us the free park hopper pass, and that's the last time I was in Disney World. Again, going out of his way, we always made a point to be able to see each other. And once we took a cruise, and we had to stop in Port Canaveral, and I know they were selling excursions, my excursion was, I'm going to see my uncle. And I let him know, and he drove to Port Canaveral, and you know, my uncle didn't like to go very far, right? But he made a point to come spend 8 hours with us. And those are the things, those are the little things, but little things can become great things if we can do it for other people. So that's how I remember my uncle. Let's see if there is anything. I have many, 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 many stories that I will continue with along the way, but what I remember is if we want to carry on his legacy, he wanted others to be comfortable, he wanted others to be happy, he wanted us all to have a good time, and maybe if we can make people a little kinder, a little more warm-hearted, laugh, then Uncle Jim, my Uncle Jim, will live forever. Thank you all for being here. Thank you, Pastor Frank.
Final song that we'd like to play as we leave today.
And this is my Uncle Jim.
That's what happens when you put the Michigan thing up there.
Thank you, everyone, so much for coming.
Thank you. And Michael Jim wants us all to go have a good time today in his honor.
Can I get a picture of you with the flag?
Absolutely.